Good evening, everyone. This is Mamta Sharma from iCharge Support Foundation, and I'm so glad to bring to you True Talks, a special interview series where we try to answer questions on various themes to understand self and life. To answer our questions, we have with us the founder and director of iCharge and iCharge Support Foundation, Nitin Shah. Welcome once again, Nitin.
Welcome, Ms. Mamta. Thank you.
And welcome all of you to this 9th episode of True Talks, in which we are today going to focus on mind and spirituality, from knowledge to wisdom. If you have any questions or suggestions, please leave them in the comments and we'll try to answer them during the interview. You can also start a watch party so that your friends can also watch this interview and benefit from it. So Nitin, in earlier episodes, I have tried touching on the topic of spirituality, and each time you have kind of circled around it. So in the last episode, you mentioned that the definition of spirituality is different for different people. So I want to understand from you today, what is your definition of spirituality?
So Mamta, my definition of spirituality is that everything there is comes from the same source. And because everything comes from the same source, everything there is spiritual. So the reason, I have generally not answered that question directly to you earlier is because I understand that different people have different definitions of spirituality. And then there are a lot of people who believe that some people are spiritual, and there are other people who believe that some people are not spiritual, and so on, right? The challenge for me is that that idea just doesn't make sense for me. If everything is coming from the same source, and we all are made up of that spirit, then by definition, we all become spirit. Everything that exists is a spirit, is spiritual. Everything that doesn't exist is also spiritual.
Makes sense.
And to that extent, I don't really understand what is it that people really mean when they when they talk about spirituality.
Okay, that's interesting. But I still want you to share your views about some of the prevalent concepts in spirituality that are there.
Okay. So I can give you my understanding of each of those concepts. Shoot the concept and I'll explain what, according to me, those concepts mean.
Okay. So let's begin with one that we kind of touched upon in one of the episodes. Bliss. What is your idea, or what is what would bliss be?
So this is actually one question, Mamta, that I had already answered during our happiness wala episode, the first episode, where in the end I had mentioned that for me, bliss is that underlying sense of happiness, that underlying sense of ease that I have, irrespective of whatever is happening in the life. So the life circumstances may be favorable, at times they may be unfavorable, but that underlying sense of faith and confidence and ease and happiness, whichever way you want to define it, that I generally experience in my life is how I would define bliss. And I think mostly I'm able to experience that, and that's the reason why I would rather define bliss that way.
Okay, but that seems sensible enough. But when I talk to people, you know, they generally say, oh, bliss is this state of some exceptional high that they are trying to experience. But what you are saying, what you just mentioned, is something quite different, is it?
It is. Because, see, as I said, different people define bliss differently. So let's do one thing. Let's ask all the people who are watching our live right now, right? Can quote in the comment section what, according to them, is bliss.
Yes.
And you'll That's be a great surprised. Idea. And as people start typing in, you'll be surprised that the definition of bliss changes from people to people. There's really no standard definition of bliss.
Right.
And that's one of the things. So especially from, because I also take therapies and so on, right? So for me, that's one of the challenges that I face when I work with people who come with bliss as an end objective. So there are times, you know, when people would come to you for therapy, they're already a part of some spiritual groups and so on. And then they would come and say that the problem they are facing is they have not experienced bliss.
Correct.
So I recently had a client like that, and I actually asked her that, can you define what bliss means? Interestingly, she did not have an answer for that. She said, I don't know what is bliss.
Okay.
So I asked her, all right, if you don't know what bliss is, then how do you know that you have not experienced it? There is a possibility that you've experienced it, but you have not just recognized it, right?
Right.
Possibly. So for all the people who are watching this video, my general suggestion to them is that when you are looking at experiencing something, please define mm-hmm. what that feeling is for you.
Mm-hmm.
Because unless you define that feeling, mm-hmm. it will be very difficult for you to recognize it. I'm not saying it will be difficult for you to feel it, because you may still feel it, but you don't really know what you're feeling is bliss or not.
Oh, yes.
Right? And so interestingly, because I was taking a therapy, and maybe I'm asking these questions because it will also guide a lot of you who are watching this live session. And if you have any right. questions, please also throw those questions to us in the comments so that I can probably address them. So when she told me that I want to experience bliss, and so I asked, all right, so because you're not able to define what bliss means to you, tell me what would change in your life once you start experiencing bliss.
Mm-hmm.
She said, I would live a happier life.
Okay.
And I said, when you say you will live a happier life, what does that happiness really mean? How would this happiness reflect in your life? What would change observably in your life? And her answer was that, Nitin, I'll get up in the morning feeling energetic. When I do work, even those things that I currently don't enjoy doing, I'll be able to enjoy them, because I would know that I'm experiencing that bliss, that I'm connected with that with that source or my God or my oneness. Right? And that when I go to my office, I'll be able to work in my office with this sense of commitment and focus. Because I'm constantly experiencing that sense of oneness and bliss. And in the night when I go off to sleep, I'll experience this sense of comfort and peace that I've lived a good day today.
Okay.
Right? Now, if you think of it, while she began by saying bliss, hasn't she actually explained to me an ideal day in her life?
Yeah, I was actually thinking about that. That would be like a perfect day to have.
Perfect. And for me, that's what bliss is about. That if you're able to have that kind of a day where all throughout the day, you're generally able to experience a sense of joy, a sense of happiness. And I'm not saying joy and happiness only coming out of what is favorable in your life. But you know, there are times when you wake up in the morning and you realize, throw anything at me and I will handle it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, when that kind of a feeling can sustain itself for days and weeks and months and probably even years, that's when I would call it bliss. That's the sustainable sense of bliss.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And that's what is bliss for me.
Oh, that's interesting. And it does make sense. It does make sense.
True.
So if you're living any day and every day with that sense of underlying joy and happiness, then yes, that would be, I think, as close to bliss as we get.
Perfect. Now, obviously, for a lot of people, at times the question is, how do we experience bliss?
Or is there a recipe?
Or is there a recipe for experiencing bliss?
Yes.
I'm going to ask you, do you remember what the recipe is?
If I can refer back to the previous episode and if I've been a good student. So we begin with a sense of purpose, like an overall purpose, which is higher than us, something bigger than us. Okay. And then we consistently work towards it with a precise plan of action.
Correct.
Right. And to be able to do that and to be able to go about our day without much upheaval, we need to be able to manage our thoughts and emotions.
Perfect.
So is that it?
Correct. So if we are able to live a life where we are living in a state of flow while being able to generate the material comfort that we need, and in all that we are pursuing a purpose which is greater than us.
Yes.
That's a recipe for bliss.
Perfect. So, and I understand bliss now, and at least from this perspective. And actually, if we combine all that, that kind of bliss is actually possible. It's not like an abstract unattainable concept anymore, if you look at it like this.
It's not only possible, it's also something which is not too difficult if you understand how to do it. Again, obviously, that's not to say that you're going to be able to live in a state of happiness and joy for 24/7 all your life. But the fact that you can sustain it to an extent where you feel that your life is in a state of joy. Right. I think that's quite possible. Look, take the example today. We are in a lockdown. We are in a self-isolation mode, right? And there are certain people who I'm sure are going through a lot of anxiety, a lot of discomfort because of what's happening.
Correct.
And at the same time, I'm also sure there are a lot of people who who know it's okay, you know, once this scenario settles down, we will either be back to normal or we will find better ways of being able to operate in this scenario. So while they may still be thinking, they may still be considering ways of being able to bring their life back to normalcy, but they are not really experiencing a discomfort. They do realize that, well, yeah, that's okay. It's a part and parcel of life and we'll take care of it. We'll handle it. And that for me becomes the idea of bliss, that I have the ability to handle whatever situations come my way. And irrespective of the situation, I am able to sustain that sense of comfort.
Correct. Makes sense. So Nitin, I understand that, you know, we can refer back to what we learned when we talked about thoughts and emotions. So what I'm saying is, if there's something stopping us from being in that state, or, you know, maintaining an overall sense of happiness and joy in our day-to-day lives, then we can, you know, always refer back to what we learned about identifying and managing our thoughts and emotions. But what if there are some deeper emotional issues or something else that is kind of interfering with this bliss?
So if there are deeper emotional issues, then I would suggest that go and visit a therapist, because that could be your fastest route. That could be your fastest route to experience bliss and sustain it. While what we have discussed in the earlier videos, a lot of those techniques and tips will be very useful. But that will be if you're not really having major issues with deeper emotional traumas and situations. The moment it reaches a deeper emotional issue, I would recommend visit a therapist. That's better. It's safer.
Okay. But the popular belief, Nitin, is that you should go and join a spiritual group because the idea is bliss.
So spiritual groups can help. Because obviously, as we discussed yesterday, there is a group dynamics that's there. I'm also hoping that some of the people who are a part of that spiritual group would probably have some amount of training to be able to help you deal with certain challenges and issues that you have. I don't really think spiritual groups are a replacement for therapy. Even when you want spiritual evolution, and if your spiritual evolution is being stopped by deeper emotional traumas, I wouldn't suggest spiritual groups as an option. It is a supporting mechanism, yes, for sure. There is nothing wrong in being a part of spiritual group. It can really be helpful, but it's not a replacement for therapy.
All right. That makes sense. And that gives me a pretty clear understanding of bliss and how you can go about achieving it. The next thing that I want to talk to you about is karma. So if you were to explain the concept, how would you do so?
All right. So if I were to ask you, before that, how would you define karma? And while I'm asking you, I would also want, if those of you who are watching the video right now, to actually write in the comments what is your understanding of karma, so that I can understand that.
Okay, my understanding of karma would be what goes around comes around. As you sow, so shall you reap.
Perfect. So, in its literal sense, if I slap you, you will slap me back.
Yes, I'll get something akin to a slap from somebody or somewhere else.
Perfect. So even if you don't slap me back, that slap will come back to me from someone else.
Correct. Or somewhere else. In some other form.
Or in some other form, right? And the pain that I've caused you would also come back to me.
Yes.
Yes?
Brilliant. Yes.
Now, so that basically means that people who harm others would also experience harm?
Correct.
But does that really happen? Haven't you noticed that most people who have a tendency to harm others, well, they just remain in a position where they keep harming others, and those who get harmed perpetually remain in a pattern where they keep getting harmed by one person or the other?
Yes, but the concept also kind of states that it could happen over, so the repercussions could come to you over several lifetimes.
Well, so yeah, that's one theory and that's one philosophy. But the point is, do we really know about past life? And when do I know that my karma from my past life have stopped and I'm generating new life karma?
There wouldn't be any, I mean, way to measure it, so to say.
Correct. And then on top of it, when, so because again, we are into a mode of therapy where we use hypnosis, and in hypnosis, at times, people do go into what is popularly known as past life regression. Right? But when we notice those therapy sessions, and by the way, past life regression therapy seems to be one of the more, what should I say, popular ways of explaining the concept of past life, that past life exists because past life regression therapy exists.
It took me a moment to get that.
Yes. Obviously, if there's a past life regression therapy, then the logic says that past life exists, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to come to that because that's not an argument that I really am convinced by. And because I teach hypnosis and I teach people how to do regression, and all of these techniques are a part of what we teach, I think this is one topic that I'm an authority to talk about.
Okay.
But even when we talk about past life regression for a moment, if you were to assume that when people go through a past life regression, they're actually in their past life, you will notice that in most lives, people actually have the same pattern.
Yes.
So the one who was getting tormented in this life, even in previous lives, many times they've got tormented.
True.
Right? Now, if that's
from their own description of it, yes.
Correct, from their own description of it. So if that was the case, then again, where is the harm coming back to people? Or is the, at least I wouldn't say where is the harm coming, but I would say, is the harm coming back in equal proportion?
True.
Right?
Makes sense.
So, so that's the whole thing. And then, as I said, the whole idea of past life regression therapy, whether when people go through past life regression therapy, do they really go in their past life or not, is a disputable theory.
Okay. Nitin, at one hand, you are saying that people do have an experience where they see themselves being tormented over and over again in various lifetimes. On the other hand, you are saying that you're not really sure whether past life exists. So how do you talk about both in the same breath?
Okay. So when I say about past life, the idea is not that I'm saying that past life doesn't exist. Technically, it may exist or it may not exist. There's really no way of proving or disproving it, like, completely, right? The two concepts that talk about past life basically are karma and past life regression therapy. Right. Now, let me explain what happens in therapy and why am I saying it. While people popularly call it past life regression therapy, it may not necessarily be past life regression therapy, though the therapeutic results are there.
Okay.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that it is a past life, which again, that does not mean that I'm saying past life doesn't exist. I'm simply saying that I'm open to both. It may exist, it may not exist.
Okay.
Right. So now, what happens with regression is when you start with people and when you're taking a therapy, many a times a lot of people would come and tell us that they have patterns in life. Like, for example, someone says that I've had multiple relationship issues and I don't figure out where am I going wrong.
Yes.
So now, because there's a pattern that tells us that things have been happening over a period of time.
Correct.
And that's the reason why we get into regression. But when you start a regression, you actually don't really know whether you would require a past life regression or not. And I know there are a lot of past life regression therapists who say that you would need a past life regression and only past life regression can help you resolve your problems. But truly speaking, how do you know? Matlab, unless you're a psychic, and to be true, even psychics get it wrong many a time.
Yeah, but there are people who specialize in, and it seems that they run the same process with every client. I mean, that's my understanding. Because that's how I see it.
Correct. And so my question to them is, how do you know that the problem that the person is facing is not because of something that happened to them when they were 1 minute old, when they were conceived? There is no way that the client would be able to remember that. At least, it's very, very rare for anyone to remember what happened just in the moments that they were conceived. And for them
at least
to remember
consciously.
At least consciously. And for anyone to remember everything that's happened since the time they were conceived till today. There could have been so many things that have happened in between that could have caused the pattern that they are in. So technically, again, because there's a pattern, we know that we need to look into the past. But whether do we need to look into past life or not, that is stretching it a bit too far. So what really happens is, because we know that we want people to look back into their life, beginning with the current life, and then if not, then wherever the client takes you, we actually guide the client in a hypnotic state and we tell them that, all right, now let's go to the point of entry of this problem. And we define what the problem is, right? So let's say relationship pattern is a problem. So the fact that there is a dysfunctional relationship pattern, let's go to the point of entry of this problem. Now, when you say this, there are a couple of possibilities. A person may go back into their current life memories the moment they were conceived or any time after they were conceived in the current life. Okay. Then there's really no question, no dispute, it's a current life memory, right? There is also a possibility that the client comes into a situation where they are narrating a situation that is playing in front of their eyes with their eyes closed, right? But the event that's playing in their mind is actually not a part of their current life. So someone who says that I'm seeing myself in a desert, but I've never been to a desert.
Okay, so you're saying in all cases, I'll actually be seeing something playing in front of my eyes. When I see the same people that are there in my life, I can say that this is from my current life. But when there are like strange scenes or people or places, like you were saying,
generally with current life, people don't really have a doubt that it's their current life, that they are able to say very precisely. And if they are not sure whether it's their current life or not, generally, it's an indicator that there is something else that's coming up in their mind, which is not completely a part of their current life.
Correct.
Right? Now, when that comes up, there are multiple possibilities. One possibility is that it's a past life. Okay? The second possibility is that the mind has just created a story to help you learn something. You know how at times when we are sleeping, we have dreams, and in dreams, we get answers to certain questions that we have?
Yeah.
Does that mean that that dream is coming from a past life?
You could never tell, probably.
You could never tell. So it may and it may not. Right? And at times you know you have seen a dream which is normal, which is really in the current frame of time. But the events are completely different from what you're experiencing in your current life. So obviously your mind has the ability to create stories in a way in which those stories can give you answers to your problems.
Makes sense.
Right? So it could also be that story.
Correct.
Right? Now, what is important for us to know is why, while I'm saying this, the therapy that works is because the therapy is not about what you've done in the past or what you have not done in the past. The therapy is more about being able to learn from whatever those experiences are, be it past life, be it current life, be it your karma. Right? And once you learn from and you're able to apply those learnings in your current life, then apparently the problem resolves. So even if I were to believe that problem that the client is facing is a karmic problem. Okay? The resolution depended on them learning from what they have done in the past and applying the learning in their current life.
Correct.
It wasn't really about them getting back equally what they've given in the past life.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So when we say that the same things will come back to you in equal proportion, probably that's a disputable concept as far as karma is concerned. And again, if you study karma from different people's point of view, you'll again realize there are so many different schools of thought who talk about karma in completely different ways.
Okay.
Right? But from for the sake of simplicity, and especially with what we have seen with therapy, my understanding of karma would be that when you do something in your life, there are two parts to it. There is an X amount of energy that you're physically sending out.
Okay, can you repeat that?
So when you do something in your life,
right,
you are sending out some amount of energy. That's physical energy, right? Even your thoughts are energy to that extent. And also, as a result of that, you experience certain emotional patterns. The energy that you sent out may come back to you, but it may come back to you in many ways. Matlab, I slapped you tomorrow, I am traveling in a train and someone just falls over me. It doesn't have to come across in a way in which it's a slap or it's something which creates pain for me. It's simply energy traveling and coming back to me. And I'm still not sure whether it will come back in the same proportion or a different proportion or a less proportion. But where it becomes important, and when it comes to suffering and when it comes to problems in our life, especially when we talk about karma, a lot of people talk about karma from the point of view of suffering, that I'm suffering because of my karma. Right?
Correct.
Now, that suffering is not about what you did per se. The suffering is more about when you did what you did, what was the feeling like, what was your emotions like, and today, have you learned from it and are you making the same mistake again if you thought it was a mistake in the first place?
Correct. Makes sense. Makes sense. And if I learn from it, I can break the pattern.
Correct. So the moment I learn from it and I start applying that learning in my life, then the pattern breaks.
Oh, and in terms of energy that you were saying, that would mean that I have, for lack of any other word, diverted that energy in another direction because I've changed my action or behavior, right?
Correct.
Which means the repercussions will also be different now.
The repercussions will also be different. Very true.
Perfect. That makes complete sense. So that means karma is not so much about the like the physics law of equal and opposite reaction.
At least from the point of view of therapy that we have noticed, it's not.
And more about learning from your experiences. So if you've been hurt or if you feel you've harmed somebody, and for some reason, the flip model is coming back to me because there we also talked about learnings.
So see, it's all connected. In fact, the reason why we have been running this series the way we are running and the way we have kind of sequenced the episodes, the reason has also been that because when you actually look at the entire series as a whole, you realize that everything that we're talking about is interconnected.
Yeah, we keep referring to the concepts that we have been talking about.
Correct. And that's the reason that while truly what we're talking about is the mind, right? But eventually all of these things, mind, emotions, spirituality, all of them come and have like a common meeting point. And it's that meeting point that probably we all are trying to figure out.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Now, just to clarify. So, you know, when we were talking about karma is not equal to equal and opposite reaction. And I still said that the karma is about learning and application of that learning in our life. Right? Now, that basically is a different interpretation to what we spoke earlier. When you said what we saw is what you reap. Right? Actually, that saying is not really wrong. It's completely correct because here in this case, what I'm learning is this seed that I'm planting. That's what I'm sowing, right? When I start applying that learning in my life, that's when I'm nurturing that seed. I'm nurturing the plant. And eventually, what I reap is the benefits of that plant that I've, that seed that I've planted, and the fact that I've nurtured it over a period of time.
So the benefits of applying, it's so it doesn't stop at learning. You have to be able to apply it, right?
Correct. So at times, many of us end up learning a lot of things, but we don't end up applying any of them. And that's the major difference between knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge is intellectual understanding.
Correct.
Wisdom is being able to apply that learning into practice.
Something as simple as I may know how to exercise, but the difference, things will change only when I get up and start doing it consistently.
Perfect.
That's
and if you're not able to do it consistently, then what do?
So we identify what is stopping us from doing it consistently and work with that thought or emotion.
Perfect. Brilliant.
Okay. All right. So we are saying that, okay, let's say I quote unquote do a bad deed or I hurt someone, but I've learned from it and I've changed my action in the future. Then its consequences will not come to haunt me. Is that true? Will that be true?
Will its consequences come back to haunt you or not? Well, it depends on a lot of factors.
Okay.
Right. So, for example, it depends on what you have done, to whom you have done it, what have you learned, right? And what have you done in terms of application of that learning?
Okay. Okay. Explain.
Okay. So, let me put it this way. So, let's say I have done something wrong to someone in the past.
Correct.
I realize that I've made a mistake.
Yes.
Right. Now, if I've done something wrong to that person, that person consciously, unconsciously, at some level wants to take a revenge.
For the sake of example, let's say he does.
Yes. Now, if I have learned from that experience and I go back and I actually correct the mistakes that I've made. Once I've corrected the mistakes and the other person knows that I've corrected the mistakes, would that person still harbor that hurt?
Should not. And part of correcting the mistake could also be me going and talking to that person, communicating it, sorting it out.
Precisely. So if you've learned, then you will actually take the corrective steps required to be able to handle the situation in a way in which that there are no repercussions in future. Right. But at the same time, there's obviously a possibility. Let's say I did something when I was a really small child to someone. Later on, I realized what I did was wrong. I felt bad about it. Now that puts a chain reaction in motion.
Right.
At some point, I am going to face consequences of it. But because I've learned from it, the chances that I'll be prepared for the consequences, or if I'm not able to be prepared for the consequences, then the chances that I would be at ease even while I'm experiencing those consequences is going to be far greater, right? So it doesn't necessarily that what's coming back to you doesn't necessarily need to create suffering for you. It may create physical pain. Right? But let's say, for example, if you meet with an accident, then there's pain in the body, right? But after the initial pain wears off, there are people who are in the hospital while their bones are broken and yet they can be at ease and they can be comfortable and they can be very jovial. They are not really suffering as a result of that, apart from the physical pain that they're experiencing.
Correct.
While some other people may be, the physical pain may actually be far less and the emotional suffering may be far greater.
It is.
Right. So when I look at karma, for me, karma is not as much about physical pain, because given the circumstances, that may or that may not happen. And then we can also learn techniques to be able to manage our physical pain.
Yes.
I mean, now when you go to a hospital, the kind of things they have to make you to help you relieve pain. It's incredible.
Correct. Makes sense.
Right. But the point is, does it still need to create suffering for you? And for me, when people talk about karmic patterns and people talk about bad karma and they say that it will come back to haunt you, for me, that's more about the suffering that it causes and not necessarily what happens in terms of the actual event. and that suffering can surely reduce to a large extent.
Okay, that's sensible enough. So while we have spoken about karma and past life, I have to ask you then, what is the, because you talk about suffering, what is the primary reason for suffering and conflict from a spiritual point of view?
So, let me put it this way. So, personally speaking, I actually think that the primary cause for suffering is conflict. And the primary cause for conflict is the fact that we have forgotten that we have come from the same source. Okay. Now, what do I really mean by that? So, at the end of the day, this is more or less accepted by most people that we all come from the same element, right? You can basically call it, you can give it the name of God, you can give it the name of consciousness, you can give it at its, in terms of science, you can call it energy. But we all have something which is common to all of us. We are all actually a derivative of the same source.
Correct.
Correct. Now, as long as we remember we are derivative of the same source, and we actually experience in our life, then the chances that I'll have a conflict with someone else is very, is considerably less, simply because I understand that the other person is nothing but an extension of me, and I'm nothing but an extension of the other person. Right? The problem happens because we lose track of that sense of oneness, and then eventually we start, what should I say? We start identifying with things which are more gross. For example, we start identifying with our body.
Right?
Now, the moment I identify with my body, then I'm saying, because my body is different, your body is different, we are two different people. And because we are two different people, now there's a scope for conflict. But if I were to see you as an extension of me, then obviously the scope of conflict would be lesser. At a more... if I have to give you like a slightly more elaborate example to explain this.
I was about to say that because we have gone really abstract. So explain this with an example.
So let me put it into more concrete terms. Right? So it's given the relationships that India and Pakistan has with each other. It is believed that many Indians, or at least some Indians, don't like Pakistanis, and some Pakistanis, I'm sure, don't like Indian.
True.
Right? To an extent, some of them actually hate each other.
Yes.
But truly speaking, they've never even met each other.
Most of them. Almost all of them.
Right? So, on what basis are they hating each other? That's because they're identifying themselves by the definition of their nation. That I'm an Indian, I'm a Pakistani. And then obviously their definition also has deeper details in terms of what is an Indian supposed to be like, what is a Pakistani supposed to be like. But those definition comes slightly later. The original level of identification is happening at the level of the nation.
The country, right.
Right. And because we are identifying at the level of nation, we are no longer connected to each other at the level of the oneness.
Correct.
Now, how this level changes? So, let's say the same Indian and Pakistani who hates each other while they're living in their own countries, they both go and stay in US. Right? Now, what happens? You may have some of them becoming the best of friends.
Yeah, I personally know some.
So, what happened? How did they end up becoming best of friends while they hated each other while they were in their own countries?
Yeah, because it's in a way like them versus the country they are in.
Perfect. So their identity changes from Indians and Pakistanis to Asians and non-Asian.
Yeah. Yes.
Right. Yes. And that's the place where when Asians are in some of these European countries, you will notice that there could be racial abuses that may take place and so on. Right.
Correct. Correct.
But what if there was an alien attack?
Now it'll be all of us versus all of them.
Perfect. Similarly, think of what is happening today. When we talk about the coronavirus, the COVID-19, there are countries who generally would not want to even refer to each other. But today, they may be very willing and very open to the idea of having business with each other, of being able to help each other deal with this crisis.
They have at least helped each other, like sending supplies and so on.
Correct. So why is that happening?
So because now we are identifying at the level of the human species versus the virus.
Perfect. So our level of identity has changed. Right. So when we can move up to the level, or we can at least mostly keep in mind the fact that we all are coming from the same source, the chances that we would have conflicts, I'm not saying we'll go away completely, but I'm saying that the chances will be comparatively less. We will at least stop having conflicts about things that don't matter.
Correct. True. Makes sense.
Now, so what I've actually explained to you in terms of oneness and identity, this actually comes from a topic in NLP, which is called levels of transformation. Okay. It's a really powerful process to actually be able to help someone experience that sense of oneness. And once you've experienced it, and if you actually practice that process with yourself over a period of time, then it's really, really difficult to continue to have too many conflicts in your life, because you literally start seeing things and people as an extension of you.
Correct.
Right. And for me personally speaking, I think that's been one of the best processes, combined with the understanding of the process and certain hypnotic sessions, that has really helped me experience a sense of connection more regularly.
Okay. That's interesting. And but Nathan, if I know right, then don't all religions also talk about oneness, one God? Then why are spirituality and religion seen as two different concepts or ideas? In fact, most spiritual groups emphasize that we are not religious groups, we are spiritual groups. So what is your view on that? And in some way, can religion aid or hinder spirituality?
Okay, so you've asked me like a couple of questions together.
Let me ask you one last.
Too many questions, right? Yeah, all right. So let's begin with the idea of spirituality, spiritual groups and
religion.
So see, as I said, for me, everything is spiritual, because it comes from the same source. So to that extent, even religion is spiritual. Right, but if you're asking me about religion and spiritual groups, are they same or are they different in my understanding? If you actually understand the modus operandi of their working, the only thing is religions have been there for longer and they are more organized than spiritual groups are. But apart from that, really at its base, the functioning is the same. All religions have their own doctrines, their own way of working, their own traditions that they follow, right? And they believe that their traditions are generally more correct than the traditions of other religions. Same is true with spiritual groups. While in spiritual groups, they can be people from multiple religions. Like in a religion, they can be people from multiple sects.
Correct.
But eventually, people who are a part of a spiritual group and who follow the spiritual group will follow a particular style of understanding, a particular, they would have a particular knowledge base that all of them are focusing on. There will be someone that they are following in terms of a spiritual guru or something, and they will have their own tradition.
Correct.
So really, to that extent, it's all the same. Okay? The key difference between spirituality and religion per se, in my understanding, is that religion over a period of time has got very bad name. Spiritual groups are saying that we are not religions, we are spiritual, are kind of trying to maintain their distance from that bad name.
Okay.
But if you look at the principles of functioning, how a spiritual group and a religious group function, I don't think there's too much of a difference.
Or we can say that they are like, we are identifying with different levels, the way we talk about levels, right?
Perfect. So both religion and spirituality are like different levels of identification. I can identify myself as by my religion, or I can identify myself by my religious, by my spiritual group.
Correct. Yeah? Right. That makes sense.
Yeah. So that's still a level of identity. Now, if because you the next question is, which is the one which is like a really interesting one, which is, can spiritual groups or religions help or hinder spirituality or our growth in the field of spirituality?
Yes. Or journey to oneness.
Or journey to oneness. Correct. So I wouldn't really call it spirituality simply because, as I said, for me, everything is spiritual. Even if you're going off the spiritual path, so as to say, there would surely be some or the other explanation to tell you that's also a part of a spiritual journey. So I guess spiritual is too broad a word to use over here. But let's talk about oneness. That will religion and spiritual groups help or hinder your journey towards oneness? It depends. Religion can actually be a really, really powerful tool to oneness.
Okay.
If you understand it correctly. And it can also be single biggest reason that will stop you from experiencing oneness.
Okay, that sounds contradictory.
So, it's contradictory because technically, again, see, like we spoke about spiritual groups earlier, I'm assuming that all religion, when they initiated, had their heart at the right place. Right? But the thing is that the biggest strength of every religion is also its biggest weakness.
How?
And that's where it becomes a bit of a challenge. So, okay, so let's take up the example of the three major religions in India, right? You'll have Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity.
Yes.
Right? All three of them believe that there's only one God. While in Hinduism, obviously, there are like theories and so on, but eventually it all comes to there's Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, and then all of they also were created from the same source.
Correct.
Right? So if every religion says that we all have only one God, where is the question of which religion is better than the other? So there is a contradiction over there that our religions believe that their religions are better than other religions, because ideally religions are supposed to be a route to that oneness, to that God. And if all religions are taking you to that oneness, then how can one be better than the second? Anyways, when I speak about how their biggest strength is also their biggest weakness, let's look at each of those religions. So let's talk about Islam first, right? One of those religions which has a codified book. So if someone has a doubt, you can refer to that book.
Correct.
And the after the book was created in the first place, the original text of the book has been preserved. So you know you are studying the original text. Right? So this is its biggest strength. And yet it's its biggest weakness, because once that it has become codified, anything that's not is considered by many people as not a part of the religion.
Right.
And if someone takes what is written in the book and gives it a wrong interpretation and teaches that interpretation, if people buy into that interpretation, that again leads to its own problem, because then they say, oh, but it's mentioned in my religious book. What's mentioned?
Correct. Correct.
It's a different thing altogether.
Hmm.
But because there's a codified book, that codification kind of mentally gives people a justification. And because the text is original, see, remember when the text was written, there was a context, there was an experience, there were life circumstances, right? And I understand a lot of people who follow religions would say that the text written in their religion is time immemorial and it can stand the test of time. Well, its interpretation still varies from time to time. Right? And then the question comes, have those texts, especially the traditions, so maybe the underlying principles, yes, but have the traditions been in sync with what is happening in our lives now? What has changed over the years? The chances are no. Right? So, strength and its weakness. Talk about Christianity. Biggest strength, a codified book. Right? But it has been updated over a period of time. right? So they have tried to keep it in sync with changing time.
Mm-hmm.
But then the problem is you don't know what the original text was. Today what you read is a modified version of it.
Correct.
Right? So it's correct. Strength or it's weakness. And if you go into Hinduism, Hinduism is an incredibly vast religion. If you believe in one God, you can be a Hindu. If you believe in multiple gods, you can be a Hindu. If you believe in nature as a God, you can be a Hindu. If you don't believe in the existence of God, even then you can be a Hindu. So correct. It literally envelops everything there is. But it is able to do that because there is no one singular codified book. There are books, but there are many books. And if you were to go and read every book in Hinduism, you'll probably require a lifetime to go through all the books. And then certain books contradict each other.
Yes.
Right? So again, its biggest strength, that there is no codified book and it's incredibly vast, is also its biggest weakness. So if we understand this, that our religion that we are following has its own strength, its own weaknesses, it's a route for us to reach towards that oneness. And we keep this in context. Then it can be a really powerful tool towards oneness because we understand the limitations also. And we are not bogged down by those limitations. We are not getting identified by those limitations. But
makes sense.
If we don't understand that, right, then it can also become the biggest hindrance in our journey towards oneness.
Makes sense. That's brilliant. I'm still processing it, whatever you said. Okay. Now that we have
one of those topics of all the talks, all the discussions that we have done, today's is probably the one and the only one that would be as abstract as we are talking about. And I am trying to put it as, to make it less abstract, but still, given the topic that we are discussing, it is going to remain abstract to be true, to some extent.
Correct. So Nitin, now that we have looked at spirituality from a different perspective, like a fresh set of eyes, I would say. But when we talk about being spiritual, when I talk about being spiritual at an individual level, I'm still looking at leading a happier, healthier life, apart from feeling that connection with oneness. The idea at the end of the day is to have a happy, healthy life.
Correct. So that oneness, the idea of oneness is that I'm connecting to that oneness. It's more like a feeling, but it's real manifestation in your real life would be the fact that you are able to live a happier, healthier, and more fulfilling life.
Perfect. So we have spoken about happiness. We have spoken about goals, thoughts and emotions, relationships with self and others, and now spirituality. But there's an important component of life that ensures that we live happily, and that's health, right?
Yes.
Is that what we are going to talk about next?
Correct. So in tomorrow's episode, we are going to focus on mind and body, and we are going to talk about how the mind influences body processes and how a lot of health issues that we have can actually be addressed with the help of being able to manage your mind more effectively.
Perfect. So we went from day-to-day things to a very abstract concept. And now we were using your term, chunking up. Now we are chunking down again, right?
Correct. So now the next episode onwards, we start chunking down again.
Okay, perfect. That makes complete sense. And I think that sums up our today's episode.
It does.
Perfect.
So if any of you who are watching the episode have any questions that we have not answered, please share it in the comments. In one of, probably we'll do one last session at the end of the True Talk, where we'll cover all the questions that we had not addressed during each of the episodes.
Oh, perfect. That would be wonderful. So thank you everyone who has joined in. Thank you, Nitin. And before I sign off, I would once again like to inform everyone that iChar Support Foundation has begun a series of initiatives with reference to the COVID pandemic that we are all facing, plus you know, several other initiatives. So there is an online support group that you can join for managing COVID anxiety. There is another support group, especially for the LGBTQ rainbow community. There is a helpline that you can call if you want to talk to a mental health practitioner one-on-one. So I would suggest that you visit the website, www.ichars, that is ICHARS.foundation, and you know, check out if you need any help or if you would like to join us in any of our initiatives. You are also most welcome to, you know, share information about these groups. So you can find out these groups on Facebook as well. So you can join the group and you can share the link to these groups and events with your friends and connections so that they can also benefit from it. Right?
Perfect. And since all of you are on Facebook already, you can also visit the IHR Support Foundation Facebook page, and you should also get details about all the initiatives that we are doing in terms of events in the event section.
Perfect. Nitin, at one point during the episode, you talked about certain hypnotic techniques, the levels of transformation in NLP. If someone wants to know more about these, then where can they check this out?
Well, if you want to know more about this, then you can also check out ichars.com, which is where we have all the training programs that we conduct. They are all listed on the ichars.com website.
Perfect. Perfect. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Nitin, for answering all those questions. And thank you, everyone who had joined in. We'll see you again, FB Live, 5:30 p.m. tomorrow with another episode of True Talks. And tomorrow we are going to talk about the mind-body connection.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Good night. Signing off.
Thank you.